South Bank Show, in association with Anderson Consulting.
Hello, born in 1933 into a theatrical family in North London, Joan Collins trained at RADA and has gone on to appear in over 70 films as well as, most memorably, the 80s soap opera, Dynasty. In this film, we look at Joan Collins' glamorous but uneven career and see how her looks, professionalism and determination have enabled her to overcome all obstacles, making her one of Britain's most celebrated exports. A gay icon, age not withering her, still sexy in her 60s, unflaggingly self-projecting, cunning but always a touch naive, the image of a star.
When you walk in the Garden of Eden, with a beautiful woman, and you know how you care, and a voice in the garden, in the Garden of Eden, tells you she is forbidden. Can you leave her there? When you're yearning for loving, and she touches your hand, and your heart starts a-pounding, and you're feeling so grand, can you leave her to heaven and obey the command? Can you walk from the garden?
Glamour is something you can't really define. It's something that's acquired, it's something that's learned. You don't have glamorous babies or children.
These are very good.
I think it's something that comes with maturity.
Fabulous.
It has a lot to do with grooming. It has a lot to do with putting yourself together. It has a lot to do with a certain amount of mystery. I think you really have to care about looking good to be glamorous. Well, we can't use that because the hair's sticking up on end.
The point about Jane is that she takes being a star incredibly seriously. And she is a star all the time. She's never not a star. She's a star 24 hours a day.
This is only the beginning.
She epitomizes glamour. You walk down the street with Joan and people call out to you all the time. If you're on her arm, you know, that they want to speak to her, they want to... They can't believe how sensational she looks.
Here's a woman who appeared never to age. A woman of steel. She is a mega figure, a huge star.
Give me the camera, you unspeakable piece of trash!
Gay people respond very much to very strong, dominant women. You know, Joan, she might not have one, but she has a big dick, you know. And a pair of low-hanging balls.
Being boring. Sorry.
Joan is a diva. She's a star.
When you're yearning for loving. We're somewhere or another here. No, my name is not Leonard Goldberg.
Oh, sorry.
My name is not Leonard. Oh, there I am. Hi. You knew I was coming, obviously. This is my star on Hollywood Boulevard, which was put on about 10 or 15 years ago. Hi. You didn't think you were going to see a celebrity on Hollywood Boulevard, did you? No, because they don't come down here very often. I first came down here, went to Grauman's Chinese Theatre and did what everybody else does, which is put my handprints and feet and see if they would match with somebody that I particularly liked. And it was very different, this street then. It wasn't nearly as sleazy. Hollywood was completely amazing.
As you can see, this is the rather small dining room. And this is the bar. And it's rather difficult to do any lavish kind of entertaining because nobody fits. So if anybody does come over here, they have to wear slacks and be prepared to sit on the floor.
Now, you say you were trained for the stage. That was in England?
Yes.
where did you do your training?
At the Royal Academy of Dramatic Art.
Ah.
So what did you learn? You were rather for a year. What did you learn there?
I learned that if you had any kind of indigenous accent, that you would never make it, which was absolutely ridiculous. I mean, everybody had to come out like a cookie cutter speaking, sort of terribly like that, like Celia Johnson and Vivian Leigh did it at the time. And there was much emphasis on really talking properly. And so I learned that. I learned fencing. I learned how to do a great character makeup. And I learned lots of plays. And so I was playing all these little roles, and I was sort of playing hooky from RADA. They didn't know, because they really looked down on people who wanted to be in the movies. In fact, my first report said, Joan has a good stage presence, but if she doesn't watch her voice, which is too light, it will be the films for her, and that would be such a pity. And an agent saw my picture and asked if I'd like to do some filming, and then he told me what I could make, that I could make £50 a day.
So one of Joan Collins' first screen appearances was in this promotional film for the Gasport. But her RADA tutor soon found out about her film activities.
So I was fired from RADA and went on to get a contract with Rank and do lots of movies.
What would you do in South America, Brian?
I'd wait to get back to you.
That's nice. Say it again.
Wait to get back to you.
I think she probably suffered the same as most English actresses did, being under contract to Rank.
It's just like the pictures, isn't it?
Just like the pictures.
All the ladies speak like that. They won't hear him advertise. All the chaps turn. They're rather like listening to an old newsreel.
Film star Joan Collins rode in on an elevated throne to be crowned Miss Press Clippings of 1952, and Joan made a gracious speech of thanks.
This is certainly a very great honour to be chosen this year Miss Press Clippings of 1952, and thank you very much. Thank you.
They made me wear white gloves all the time. They said you can't go out without makeup. You have to wear makeup all the time. I was still a teenager.
I'm 16, and I can do as I please. Roy Walsh knows how to treat a girl. Give her a good time.
He's no good, I tell you. Look what happened to Alfie.
That's no affair of mine.
Well, it is of mine, and you're not going out with that little swine and that. Give me that!
They cast you as the bad girl, didn't they, in Kosh Boy and Turn the Key Softly, and the newspaper said you were the coffee bar Jezebel at
yes.
the time. But what did you think about these roles, which became you, the sort of bad girl, the delinquent?
What did I think about them? I think I'm better in the stronger roles. I'm quite a strong person. I have strong looks in terms of being dark and having flashing eyes. In Our Girl Friday, in which I was a petulant, spoiled little
bossy
bitch wrecked on a desert island with Hattie Jakes as my mother, and these three men lusting after me, I thought was all rather good fun.
Call yourselves men. You're nothing but a bunch of stupid kids that can't be trusted. Well, I've been doing some thinking since last night, and from now on, I'm in charge. You'll take charge of the fishing and the fire. And
Joan came into movies at a time when women were cast as in one of very, very few roles. And Joan being dark and having very strong, handsome, good looks, just continually got cast in these rather shallow, ball-breaking, sexually avaricious, other women-type roles.
You say you love me, then you must choose for us both.
Joan Collins' big break came when Daryl F. Zanuck saw her in this film and offered her a contract with 20th Century Fox in Hollywood.
Either I am yours, and you help me, or I go on without you. Which is it to be?
There was the spark of a very good leading lady there, but she needed Hollywood to broaden her.
Hollywood was completely amazing. It was unbelievably glamorous. It was everything that I had always thought it would be. I remember I arrived in November and the sun was shining and it was hot and these wonderful people with American accents met me and made me feel like I was something fantastic and beautiful. Everybody was beautiful or handsome. The shops were fantastic. Within the first two or three days after I'd arrived, I had a telephone message from every eligible man, young, middle-aged and old, in Hollywood, because I was the new, young, pretty kid in town.
I mean, I think Joan really led a blazing trail because, you know, when she came to Hollywood, she was a very forceful, dynamic presence. And let me see how I can put this politely. I think she did her own thing sexually, and I don't think women were doing that at that time.
Did you see Joan Collins while you were there?
I met Joan Collins while I was there over the year, yes. To me, she seemed quite American. I mean, she had been given an American accent, and she talked with a very strong American accent and American phrases, which she seemed to have picked up very quickly. She seemed to me to have lost a specific English quality that she had over here, you know?
I think people have the mistaken idea that if you're pretty, it's terribly easy to become an actress. You're plucked from behind the soda fountain or from behind a drugstore and you're put under the screen, which happened 20 years ago and 30 years ago and quite recently, but it doesn't happen anymore.
But do you think that time at Hollywood, when you were very young and you were very hot, do you think that informed your idea of what glamour really was?
Oh, absolutely. That was what was so fantastic. Within the first year, I probably met everyone. I remember going to Gene Kelly's house. Alana Turner, Ava Gardner, Marilyn Monroe, they were there. I realized that if you want to be glamorous or groomed, it was very time-consuming. And the publicity people were with you all the time. I was doing layouts all the time. The movie that they put me into, The Girl in the Red Velvet Swing, they had bought for Marilyn. But then they thought that she was too old because the girl was supposed to be 17. So when I got this role, the British press said, Joan takes over in role for Marilyn. It was all frightfully exciting.
My mother taught me a proverb. If you lie down with dogs, you get up with fleas.
When I was doing The Girl in the Red Velvet Swing one day, I went into the commissary, my hair pulled back and no makeup. And Richard Fleischer, who was the director of The Girl in the Red Velvet Swing, came over to our table and he said, what are you doing? I said, what do you mean? He said, you can't go out looking like that. He said, you look hideous. And he said, no, no, do not go out without makeup on. Always be dressed properly. Don't forget you're a star. Or maybe you're not a star yet, but you will be. They were trying to make me a star.
Broadway, how do you like your caviar? With a soupçon of lemon or a whisper of onion?
Caviar?
There's the caviar. You've never had any?
Don't tell Gwen.
Oh, cross my heart. I'll fix you some the way I like it. Just a little caviar. And a touch of onion. There, you see? And you just put that in your mouth.
Thank you.
Tastes better with champagne.
So, did you enjoy playing with Bette Davis?
Well, she terrified me. Mm. She terrified
everyone. Terrified everybody, I hope.
Everyone. She was the most terrifying woman. I mean, a wonderful actress, but she was very much in a world of her own.
Madam, who is it? Lady Raleigh.
And she would stomp around the set with her head shaved because she was playing Queen Elizabeth I. And a red wig perched on the back of it, smoking. I mean, always smoking, the entire time, in this huge Elizabethan gown, which was wonderful. And I and the five other girls playing her ladies-in-waiting, all of us between the ages of sort of 19 and 21, would cower in a corner, giggling nervously and chewing gum, and terrified that she might pick on us.
Sir Walter will not sail. He will return here to be with me. Take care how you treat your queen's possessions, Mistress Throgmorton.
I'm sorry, ma'am.
Are you well? Your face looks drawn.
Quite well, thank you, ma'am.
I had been told you fainted in chapel Sunday last.
It was nothing, ma'am.
I had a bit of a run-in with her once when I was trying to tie her shoe, and after that I think she respected me because I didn't let her get away with it.
Take her away! Take her away!
By 1962, Joan Collins had completed 12 Hollywood movies, working with some of the biggest names in the business.
There's Violent Love, with Alice, who clung like a tigress to the man every other woman wanted.
I've been an actress now for 10 years, and I really, at that time, was fed up with filming. And I really was getting broody. And I had sort of, you do that thing subconsciously, women do, that would be a good father for my children.
If I say I love you, do you mind?
In 1962, Joan Collins met singing star Anthony Newley.
Make an idol of you, do you mind?
The first time I saw Anthony Newley, I thought he was gorgeous and cute and funny and sexy. It's the beginning of the 60s. He was then the enfant terrible, or the new young major talent of the moment.
Now I think of heaven, do you mind?
I asked Joan for a date. And, of course, I took my camera along, didn't I?
You and Joan on the first date?
Wimbledon Common. And Joan looks, even then, she was gorgeous.
I want to whisper sweet nothings in your ear. Nothings that are meant for my love alone to yours. And if I say I love you,
but when you married him, you did put your career on hold. Was that a conscious decision?
I still had those old-fashioned notions in the back of my head. I mean, Daddy was always saying, it's so wonderful that you finally found a good man and you're settling down and all of this acting nonsense is behind you. And besides, you're too old now, you're pushing 30 or something like that. My father was so ageist.
Joanie?
Joan?
Joanie, just, I'd like the folk to see your...
Your knees.
Your knee.
And your lace socks. Hello, Joan.
Come on.
Glad to see you. Sit down between us.
Yes.
You know, now see, you look great.
Thank you.
Now, that's nice. That looks great.
I had to be the camp follower. I had to follow Tony. I was perfectly happy, and I was terribly happy. Then Sasha came along, 18 months after Tara, and I was delighted with my life for quite a long time.
If I tell you, honey, this is how I think of heaven. Do you mind? Do you mind? Do you mind?
Harry?
Yes?
You've been using the internet at peak rate.
And you've run up this enormous phone bill.
And this will have to go towards paying for it.
And this.
And this.
And... this.
No. No.
Harry?
I dreamt I ran up this huge peak rate phone bill.
No, you didn't.
Yes, I did.
No, you didn't. Look.
Now, with AOL, it's off-peak all the time. So it's never more than a penny a minute, whatever the time.
So it's cheap rate now?
Well,
yes, and it'll still be cheap rate in the morning.
Night, Connie.
Night.
It's all part of the service at AOL.
At BP, we don't think it matters what colour your car is, as long as it's green. That's why we're introducing cleaner, greener diesel that will substantially reduce emissions. So now, with BP Greener Diesel, your car can be a little greener. BP, for the journey ahead.
Tomorrow's 10p Evening Standard invites you to spend £10,000 on the Millennium Party of your dreams. You win, and we'll organise the rest, with whoever, doing whatever, and wherever. Well, almost. Win the Millennium Party of your dreams, starting in tomorrow's 10p Evening Standard.
Stunning, electrifying, superb, a gem. Ralph Fiennes, Liv Tyler, and Yeagan.
Welcome to an American state with wide open spaces where the views are breathtaking, a region rich in produce, local dishes, fine wines, food from the sea. But if you want, there's bustle, commerce, information, the urge to get things done. You'll find the people are warm. They'll always be helpful. That's just the way it is here. You'll find the state at 35,000 feet.
We'll be landing in about 45 minutes.
Did you know?
85% of customers say they hate it when businesses get their details wrong. So how do you make the right impression?
Complete rubbish.
Visit our website.
The thing about the Scots, right, is I don't like Wembley. The pitch, the stands, the crowd.
The English.
That's why I think an England win. Scottish keeper.
Hostile. Native.
Probably 2-0. Maybe 3.
Nah, they're bound to get one.
You reckon?
Well, they did all right.
Fancy yourself as a football expert? Then use your knowledge to get lucky. Call 0870 747 1966. Pick 3 correct scores out of 6 chosen matches and you're a winner. Pick more and it could be a fortune. Score, the simple way to bet on football.
With AOL, internet calls are off-peak all the time. Any day, any time. It's never more than a penny a minute. So why not give us a spin?
This has certainly changed. This is 1151 Summit Drive, where I lived in the late 1960s with my husband, Anthony Newley, and my 2 children, Tara and Sasha, and many dogs. I thought it was absolutely beautiful, wonderful house, perfect to raise children. In fact, when the children talk about Summit Drive, they still talk of it with enormous fondness as though it was, you know, the happiest home that they had had, and indeed it was. And then the 3 years that we were here, it was idyllic. It was wonderful.
My ship has sails that are made of silk. The decks are trimmed with gold. And of jam and spice, there's a paradise in the home. My ship's aglow.
Joni knew everybody, so our house was always full of everybody who'd always wanted to meet. It was a village in those days. Beverly Hills was a small village, and stars walked about the street.
In a sapphire sky when my ship, I can wait the years till it appears.
We were part of what is called the young Hollywood scene. We partied a lot. And in this hall is where we used to have our parties. It's exactly the same, except for the decor, which is not to my taste, but my lips are sealed. And this, I remember, was changed when Sammy Davis bought it, and he put in what is called a conversation pit. I remember sitting at this bar, and I sat here with various people, beautiful flowers, and they were all trying to get me to take some white powder, which I didn't do. So Sammy leaned over, he was wearing a dark velvet jacket, and he said, "Come on, Joni, have some." And he gave me the white powder, and I looked at it in his hand, and I went, and I blew it all over his dark jacket. He wasn't pleased.
I've got some film here of Joni and I a couple of days before she gave birth to Tara. And as you can see, she is such a marvelous mover, even with Tara hanging in her belly. But Tara came out 2 or 3 days after this show.
But the pearls and
Tony Newley's career was just in the ascendant. I mean, he was going up, up, up into the stratosphere. He was offered a movie contract. It was a rather idyllic time, a rather fun time.
I never saw them fight. They always seemed to have a great relationship. In fact, I think it's the happiest I've ever seen Joan when she was with Tony.
Everybody had children, young children.
I sing, doesn't also bring my own true love to me. If the ship I sing doesn't also bring my own true love.
to wear that I was living in the Garden of Paradise, and I thought, oh, everybody lived this way, obviously. And it was only in retrospect that I realized that we were really on Mount Olympus, and they were an unbelievably glamorous couple, obviously. And we lived, it was like something out of a Fitzgerald novel, you know, everybody was dressed in white and wonderful garden parties and lots of extraordinary personalities there. Peter Sellers and Sammy Davis and, you know, were great friends who were always there. And there was always laughter and the clinking of glass, you know, ice in glasses. I mean, it was really heady stuff.
And this was Tony's study, which he used to work and compose. He had a desk there, he had a sofa there, and the chair. This is where we told Sasha and I that we were getting a divorce, right in that place there.
Anthony newly made the musical Hieronymus Merkin, in which you and your family appeared. Did that represent parts, aspects of your life in L.A.?
Yes, that was a very sad, occurrence. Because really what it was it was showing the death of our marriage.
Can you give us any clue as to what the picture's about before we see it?
The hero is a guy called Hieronymus Merkin, who falls in love with a girl called Mercy Hunt. And what we're all desperately interested to know is, can he forget her and find true happiness?
I understand, as a matter of fact, those are a couple of the straighter names in the film.
Oh, yeah, but there's some wild name, Polyester Poontang.
I know Polyester.
It was all about this 38-year-old man who's coming to a midlife crisis, and in the background, yeah, is his wife, Polyester Poontang, played by, and his two children, Thumbelina and Thaxted, played by Tara and Sasha.
Where have you been? The gang misses you.
And it was very true to life.
What's the matter? Your wife got your tongue? Are you going to let a marriage and a couple of kids get in the way of our friendship? Ah, I get the picture. The old ball and chain. Okay, lady, I've been up against your kind before. You're the kind of a woman who wants to make a marriage work no matter what havoc you wreak on your husband.
I think Mom initially was probably rather excited to be into it until she saw the content. He was holding nothing back. He was really telling the whole truth about his frustrations as a married man and so on.
I don't remember a lot because we were quite wee at the time. But I did have one speaking line which I remember to this day.
Come on, Daddy.
Mommy, Daddy's calling you, I think it was.
No, it's Daddy, Daddy, Mommy.
Oh, was it? Well, after all this time. It's amazing, I can remember it at all.
Daddy, Daddy, Mommy's calling you.
He was a rampant exhibitionist. Anybody in show business is. It's not entirely healthy to want to reveal everything. Because he wanted everything to be seen, no matter how upsetting. And I think it sort of came apart at the seams.
You show people. Such finesse.
She's touching my arm. Touch her back.
I remember seeing it alone in a screening room in Soho. And I was in floods of tears at the end of it.
Chalk and cheese. We're as different as chalk and cheese. Were there ever two people more out of step? Before, more unlike, if you please. Souls apart, we are opposite poles apart. When I think about me and you, Sam, how'd you do? Maybe it wasn't so smart. Me, I'm bright, got a groovy scene. I like to be where it's at. You're uptight as a tambourine. What kind of music is that?
So I came out of that screening room with very red eyes and lots of Kleenex balled up in my hand and realizing that I had to get a divorce.
You like it? It's not quite right yet.
After her divorce, Joan Collins returned to London, where she appeared in 12 unmemorable films in the space of 3 years.
Next time I'll use the hand with the knife.
After some time in England with your third husband, Ron Cass, you moved back to Hollywood. What was that like? I mean, the first time you'd gone, you'd been applauded and welcomed. What was this like going back then?
Well, work-wise, no, of course, it was very different. The studio system was gone. I was no longer a player in the movie business at all.
But you've had your ups and downs. There's a point in your marriage to Ron Cass when I read that you're on the dole at one stage.
But it wasn't my favourite experience, to say the least. Standing in this queue, and rather sort of dressed up, because I'd been to opening some boutique, and so I was wearing a raincoat, and I'd driven up in a Mercedes, and the car was completely full of flowers that had been given to me. And this girl said, "Didn't you used to be Joan Collins?" I said, "Yes, I still am." She said, "What are you doing here?" Everybody craning their neck to have a look to see what is she doing there. And I thought, this is ridiculous. I mean, what am I doing here?
Well, I just don't care what the rest of you do. I am going to go in this direction.
Marilyn!
In 1977, Joan Collins felt that her career had reached rock bottom.
I went off to the Florida swamps to do something called Empire of the Ants, which I really had to do because we really were short of money. While I was doing that, I thought, this is the most humiliating, stupid experience. I'm doing this dreadful film. I'm getting $35,000 for it, which will be very helpful. But the school fees, children, mortgage. And I thought, I've got to try and do something to resurrect my career. And I looked at myself objectively. I thought I still looked good. And my sister had written a book called The Stud. So I called Jackie and I said, would you give me an option for free, sister dearest? And so she did. I did it to resurrect my career, and I did it for the money.
And did it do both? Did it resurrect your career and make the money?
Yes, it did both, I have to say. I liked The Stud. I thought it was a really good film.
Why do you keep him?
Ooh.
Tony. Darling, he's my masterpiece. I own him. I have turned a common waiter into one of the most fancied young men in London, more or less, with my bare hands. I totally redid him. Clothes, hair, even sex. Especially sex.
One of the things we're trying to say in this movie is that the people who are written about in the gossip columns and who are considered by the average reader to have everything, to have money, to have fame, to have success, to have looks, to have all of those rather materialistic things, are basically very sad, very lonely, and very lacking in a lot of the human qualities.
We don't want to make a confessions-type cheesy film. I know they make a lot of money, but I think this film should have a little style and a little class.
What's going on?
It's an emergency.
What's that?
That's your cue.
I only realised who she was when I met her and started to make this film with her. I hadn't been aware of her before that, to be totally honest with you.
Where's your husband?
Cost nothing to make. We shot the thing in 3.5 weeks. I think it cost 350,000 quid in those days to make. I mean, he took off and he made millions very, very quickly. And it's now become a sort of a cult classic.
That was nice.
Well, it was certainly the first film, as far as I know, that she ever took her clothes off in.
It's a nice coat. Is it new?
This? No. I've had it for hours.
Jeez.
Oh, lover, you're so predictable.
She
never
wasn't a spring chicken. She looked fantastic. And eventually got right into it.
Look,
loved it.
I'm really tired.
I remember we shot in the scene with the... Well, she's on a swing with somebody and all that. Well, she was having a big laugh by then. So in a sense, she went through her own little liberation.
Ha-ha! Alexis Carrington Colby is born. And if you look at the movie of The Stud, and you look at Dynasty, you will see that it's virtually the same character. I think that the makers of Dynasty, although they'll never admit it, saw this movie, saw the character, saw how great she was playing this kind of bitchy, slightly older woman, very beautiful.
Why is it that however dashing a man looks, he never knows what to do with a black tie?
they're going to be late for the party.
I don't think anyone ever had to tell her about Alexis. We said, this is the character. She read the first script, and boom, she had it.
How did you see the character of Alexis? I mean, what did you put into it?
I changed the script a lot. I had to give her more humor because it was too grand guignol, a lot of the things that she would say. So I tried to make her more amusing, and that's why Alexis smiles a lot, because some of the things that would be said with a straight face would be just so ghastly. And I would say, I can't say this line. It's impossible to say. And so then I realized, I'm a writer. I can't say this line. I change this line. So I would change the lines to make myself...
What did the scriptwriters think about that?
Listen, all they care about is ratings. And the ratings were going up and up and up. And they said, she said modestly, that a lot of it was due to me, was due to the fact that women loved Alexis because Alexis was a woman who did exactly what she wanted to do. And she treated people in business like rich, successful businessmen had treated people. Always.
It's my name that's being dragged through the mud. Mine.
Careful, careful. Don't get too carried away.
I am not carried away. I'll show him. I am going to take away everything that Blake Carrington has ever worked for. I am going to drag him into a pit so deep that he's never going to get out.
It was the number one show.
This is Warben.
It was sold to over 80 countries. Alexis and Crystal became, in certain parts of the world, the most popular girls' names for a period of sort of 2 years. The Dynasty look, the big shoulder pads and the small cinched-in waists, was copied by women endlessly.
Joan Collins and Linda Evans were the only stars among the models, but the real center of attention was the collection of costumes, each one worn on the hit series Dynasty, which has made a trademark of its glamorous wardrobe.
When Joan Collins wore her first gown on the show, there were at least 50,000 inquiries about where they could buy the outfit.
This was Joan's first appearance as Alexis in Dynasty. That was my first sketch. We ended up the fourth, fifth, 6 years probably with the largest clothes budget ever allotted to a television show.
How much input did you have when Nolan Miller was designing those costumes?
He actually put the ball in my court. He would say, what do you want to wear? And I said, well, I think a white dress would be great with a very small waist and a diamond necklace. Yeah? Yeah, done. And they'd make it.
Joan loves clothes. She loves being involved. She always had a lot of input. And the only thing, once in a while, she'd say, do you think we're going over the top? And I'd say, no, not at all. Joan was probably the most recognizable actress in the world. She's truly one of the last glamorous film stars.
It's hard to believe, but yes, Americans really have been spending $10,000 for each of these Joan Collins dolls.
She wears very valuable diamonds. She has 12 five-point diamonds in her necklace. Each earring has 3 4-points and a 5-point diamond. This is black llama mink, and it's monogrammed with her initials. And it's got the furrier, Ben Kahn, the furrier to the stars. His label is in the stole. I don't think I should go any higher than that, do you?
That character is a pastiche, and is an awful lot of it is tongue-in-cheek. Although with Joan, of course, like everything, she did it incredibly seriously.
Well, I didn't cause your accident, Crystal, just as I didn't cause your barrenness. So, if you've quite finished...
I haven't.
It was obviously a program of its time, and if you do look at it now, it does seem fantastically dated. Because it's absolutely set in its moment. It's now fantastically dated.
£150. Ridiculously uncomfortable shoes, £70. French perfume, £49. Not being mum, at least for one night.
Wow.
priceless. There are some things money can't buy. For everything else, there's MasterCard. Accepted for everything, even home improvements.
For the ultimate in retail therapy, follow three simple steps. One, print your own money. Two, print your own money. And three, print your own money. Go on, take advantage.
I want to break free. I want to break free.
There is a place where the normal rules of high street shopping do not apply. Place where you can save up to 50% on designer fashions and famous names every single day. This place is Freeport Braintree. Break free from high prices.
From the 8th of November, one of these will be coming through your door. It'll tell you what you need to know about the Millennium Bug.
It'll sort out the facts from the fiction. If you read it, keep it, get the facts and act on them.
There's no reason not to have a happy, bug-free New Year. Cheers.
Protect your future with the pension and investment strength of Norwich Union.
Welcome to an American state with wide open spaces, where the views are breathtaking. A region rich in produce, local dishes, fine wines, food from the sea. But if you want, there's bustle, commerce, information, the urge to get things done. You'll find that people are warm. They'll always be helpful. That's just the way it is here. You'll find this state at 35,000 feet.
We'll be landing in about 45 minutes.
I think he has a persuasive nature about him.
I thought he was a thug. He growls.
He's on the go all the time.
He'd always be ringing me on my mobile or on the way to the track or at the track. How's he done? Is he run well?
He started dancing with my nan and he was like on the floor and spinning round. On your knee. It was really embarrassing.
He eats like a horse.
Loves beetroot.
He's really, really quiet.
We will speak on the telephone at least 8 times a day and that's wherever we are.
Welcome to your world from one to one.
Director of Sense and Sensibility.
Well, you say we fight for nothing.
We fight for everything we ever had.
Ride with the Devil.
But Joe, as a theatrical agent, what was your reaction when, as a schoolgirl, Joan told you she wanted to be an actress?
Oh, I was so against it. I can't tell you. I screamed and I said, no way, no way.
I think we both had difficult relationships with our father. I think that I learned to live with it and that Joan had a lot of problems with it.
I mean, he was a very opinionated man and he was a very dogmatic man. And I think he really thought that I wasn't going to make anything of myself.
Do you think you're like him at all?
I have his impatience and his belief in that if you want to get something done, you better do it yourself. And that was really what we were brought up with, both Jackie and I.
I think she was constantly searching for the man of her dreams who would be not the father figure, but who would replace the father figure. I think that was a constant search in her life. Maybe that's why she's been married a few times.
Joan Collins' first marriage was to up-and-coming British star Maxwell Reed when she was just 18 years old. The fact that he raped her on their first date might seem an inauspicious start, but the marriage did manage to survive 18 months before Joan finally walked out. At the age of 30, Joan embarked on marriage number 2 to 60s singing star Anthony Ewing. A happy time for Joan. This produced Tara and Sasha, but eventually foundered on the rocks of Newley's compulsive womanizing. In 1972, aged 39, Joan married husband number three, Ron Cass, who ran Apple Records for the Beatles. When he lost his job, Cass turned to drugs and managed to spend most of Joan's money.
He's not living up to his, and that is...
Joan's fourth attempt was a total disaster.
There's clearly no love lost between the famous couple. Earlier this month, Mr. Holm locked himself in the Hollywood Hills mansion he shared with the actress, threatening to shoot anyone who tried to evict him. And he told of a...
Her 1985 marriage to Swedish pop star Peter Holm ended in one of the messiest divorces in Hollywood history. She can now only bring herself to refer to him as the Swede. Joan now lives in unwedded bliss with young art dealer Robin Hurston.
It's like failure's not an option. It's like that. She's a Marine in that sense, you know. She's absolutely go forward and cut away the dead growth, cut your losses.
I've never made any money in property, ever. Mm. I have only lost on everything I have ever bought. Some people buy apartments and regularly sell them and make a huge profit. Mm-hmm. And I
but
buy
you're lucky in love and very good at games, so
yes.
It makes up. Nothing, you know, she's sort of Teflon coated. Nothing hinges, nothing snags on her. She's constantly cleansing herself of negativity and moving into the future. So it's a great survival tactic, you know. I like the one,
but you've got it in the exhibition in Brighton. It's the one of me reclining.
It's in there somewhere. I can't find
Recamier.
I did two pictures of her. The first one, I think, is probably the better one, but it's the less flattering one.
This is a picture of Dorian Gray.
Yes, as Michael Caine said.
Did he say that?
Yeah. I used hog hair brushes. You know, it's a picture of the psyche, the energy, rather than you.
Yeah, but it doesn't look like it's got a lot of energy. I look like I'm
You look
very
a bit twisted.
Terribly tense.
Yeah. Often the good portraits aren't flattering. And the second one was a sort of apology for the first. I see my mother in three dimensions, see the person behind the scenes, who is this extremely vulnerable, still, you know, starry-eyed, still, I think, a trifle amazed that she's who she is. I mean, there's still very much the 12-year-old girl who used to fill scrapbooks with cuttings of Clark Gable and so on. You know, that's still operating in her, and that's, I think, the ballast that keeps her from tipping over into the stardom side of things.
We all know what actresses are like. They can be on, and when they're on, they're a pain in the ass. But when she's just being herself, she's a lot of fun.
If she's not happy the way that is right for Joan Collins, the professional, she doesn't have to let you know. And you really feel it. It's a fantastic frodeur in her house in the south of France. She has a room which is floor to ceiling. It's framed covers of magazines that she's been cover girl on. And she calls it the Norma Desmond room. She's been very good at marketing and branding herself. There is an absolute look that is Joan Collins, and it is unmistakable. And it comes down to some very, very strong visual images that are almost cartoon-like.
My Olympus iZoom 75 camera.
That's me.
She claims that this lens is so sharp that it picks out every line and wrinkle.
Oh. I think they like you, Marissa.
Something scoundrel. My favorite fragrance.
Joan is definitely a brand. She knows exactly where her parameters are. And that may have limited the sorts of roles that she will take in the past. That said, she has done quite a range of things. I mean, she's played, you know, Cockney housewives, and she did Decadence with the Stephen Berkoff film, which was really quite a brave thing to do.
The asses of the men look small and pretty, bouncing on their steaming steeds, snorting from their sculptured snouts. What a sight! Off we go!
How do you enjoy working on Decadence with Stephen Berkoff?
Stephen is a marshmallow. Underneath all of that tough East End wide boy attitude. He is, you push him like this and he'll just open up.
Well,
and
I think if you push him like this, I think maybe if other people push him like this, their finger will be bent, but that's a different argument.
Well,
but how did you enjoy playing with him in Decadence?
I loved it.
I found that you had to direct her, and direct her very carefully, otherwise she'd fall into her old habits. Well, I think she's very underrated as an actress. I think actually she has quite considerable powers as an actress. There is underneath, if you scratch the surface and you scrape off all that veneer and gloss and makeup and lipstick and kind of silicones or whatever else she's got and plastic, underneath there is more silicone and plastic, but then you scrape that off, and then underneath that is a real live human being, and a very vital one and a highly intelligent one.
I saw up high.
In Decadence, Joan Collins plays two parts, a rich upper-class woman and a slovenly housewife.
Knows about you, dear.
So I said, be raw, have no makeup, take away who that person is, get rid of the facade, and then see what would happen. From there, she started to find herself and was able to dive into the character very easily.
Thanks, love. I feel a little better now.
When I found out, I'll kill the filthy cow I bought.
First, you know how you do, I cried for days, but now I'm calm. Like the sea, all tempest-tossed. You've thrown this way and that, like things screwed, if you like, by some big black cat. You can't think for the storm shoved up. After, in the trough of calm.
At one stage, you wanted to bring Christopher Biggins into the equation on Decadence, didn't you? What would Christopher have brought to it?
Oh, that's right. Well, Stephen was way above his head.
Yeah.
I have to say that much as I respect Stephen, the crew did not. And there was a lot of rebellion in the ranks. In fact, I thought there was going to be a mutiny at one point. And he then said, I can't do it all. I can't act and direct and play these six parts and do it all. I said, well, why don't you get somebody to help you? You need somebody to help you. You need somebody who's an actor and a director. And so I suggested Christopher, because I thought he's a very good actor and he's a director.
But she has an entourage of kind of supporters. They're almost like a kind of Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. You have these seven dwarfs and they come around with the tent pegs holding up the great tent, which is Joe.
Let's all have a game.
Oh, yeah.
A truth game.
Yeah. Yes! Let's spin the bottle, then!
We filmed it as Joan and her party, and people like Chris came into it, and he was very, very good. You know, he was... These were types which were part of that decayed, almost kind of febrile... arse-licking group of Joan and the Thing, and therefore her friends suited that role.
I get back. Oh, once upon a time. Now you all just sit there, and I'll be Scheherazade.
She found it a little bit of a kind of a fascinating leap into the darkness, to project onto the public the unvarnished Joan, and she took to it. And then when we saw the rushes. I was astounded. I thought, here's the best performance I've ever seen Joan give, ever seen her give on film.
They say money's the best lubricator. No need for carry. Why?
You sound just great. I can eat you up.
You look like a lioness. Well, I feel like you cub. Take your niggers off. I wanna fuck.
Tell you the truth, I'd rather have a sack.
I didn't like the film at all, but there was no doubt of her extraordinary ability to make you watch her rather than anybody else, and there were only two of them in it. She pulls you right in.
Not an inch untouched. Now, Arnold.
In Joan Collins' latest film, which she co-produced with Nigel Hawthorne, she takes on another challenging role as an aging nouveau-riche widow.
I have a little dairy fitted out entirely to my own taste.
Oh, yes.
At luncheon, I should hope for the honour of your lordship's company.
Oh.
To take some terrine of home-killed pig.
Look.
And a syllabub warm from the cow.
Oh. Well, I have every moment a fresh opportunity of admiring the elegance of Mrs. Heidelberg. The very cream of delicacy and milk.
I think she's the sort of actress that very much blossoms when she's given a lot of direction. And I think that Joan can be a very good actress, indeed. Probably Joan likes to keep within her range. And perhaps that's why, you know, you haven't seen her playing Medea, haven't seen her playing something exceptional. Perhaps she feels more at home playing the society bitch.
There's been trouble, all right, but I'm sure you can handle it.
So perhaps as an actress, that is her problem. She's been too frightened to delve into her real self. And so we don't really see the real Joan. We see what she thinks the real Joan is expected to be. At times, I rather am inclined to dread the war paint going on, because it's almost as though she paints on Joan Collins. The real lady, underneath it all, is very, very warm.
Do you think that you have fulfilled your potential, the girl who went to RADA? I mean, do you look back and say, we should have done that, could have gone that way, we should have spent a bit more time on that?
I wish I'd done a really good film. I wish I could say, if somebody said, well, what are you most proud of? I could say, I did Sons and Lovers, for example, which I should have done, which Warren made me turn down, and Mary Ewart did the part and got the Oscar. But I can say, oh, I did Dynasty. And Dynasty, I think, is probably the most successful television series ever made, and I was probably the most successful television actress at the time. So therefore, one can say, oh yes, well, I didn't play Hedda Gabler, but you know something? I didn't really want to play Hedda Gabler.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Exchange tapes. Right. Can I check my visage? Is that all right?
It's
you don't sweat. Indeed. That's unbelievable. Stella, did my hair look all right? I don't look like Nancy Reagan.